So today I have the privilege of sitting down with Karen Horan. Karen is a paramedic with Williamson County EMS who has been here for a few days. She is also one of our senior medical officers. So Karen, welcome to the podcast.
Pleasure to be here.
Tell me about this. You have been doing this for a long time. I hear because, you know, I am new to this and certainly have not been around to see you be here. Actually, I believe I can remember working with you here and teaching with you, many years ago.
Yeah.
So, Karen, when did you get an interest in EMS and how did you get started?
It's a long and complicated pathway. What it amounted to is I had been working for the Texas Legislative Council writing legislation. And I spent a lot of time doing that, and my thought process was, if I can help craft legislation where the spirit of the law and the letter of the law are so closely tied that you cannot circumvent the spirit with the letter, then I was going to be doing a good job. Well, it turns out that people don't like that. Legislators really fight that process. And I had the Speaker of the House come up and put his arm around me and thank me for the fine job I was doing. And this particularly slimy Speaker of the House, that hug was the last straw. I went into the Senate bathroom and locked the door and proceeded to wash because I felt besmirched and went, I've got to do something else. Left.
That type of hug.
Oh my goodness. So I left. I went off to Europe for 5 months wandering around, came back and said, what am I going to do to make the world a better place? In the meantime, while trying to figure out...
Step one, leave the legislature.
Step one, definitely leave the legislature. What am I going to do when I grow up to make the world a better place? Had some friends who ran a pain control clinic. I moved in as their office manager just because they really needed somebody. Ended up helping them out do a lot of the biofeedback. And the physician in charge of this particular clinic was a psychiatrist who got to the point he was taking so many of his own psychotropics, he would come in someday with half his mustache shaved off and he didn't even notice. The point is, 1 week we had two people go into cardiac arrest in the office. The doctor didn't know what to do. No one else knew what to do. I at least knew CPR. And I went, well, somebody's got to do some medicine. So I took an EMT class.
Interesting. So when was this?
This was in 1990.
Outstanding.
Yeah.
Now, where did you go to EMT school?
I went to EMT school at ACC.
ACC. Very
yeah.
good.
Yeah, I did just a plain EMT class in the summer, and then I did a challenge exam to get into the paramedic program.
So you've been hippieing your way around Austin for quite some time.
I have. I've been here since the early 70s, back in the days when you could go knock on the back door of the Armadillo and go, I don't have any money, but if I sweep the place, will you let me stay? And you'd do that. You'd hang out backstage, listen to some great music, meet some interesting people. There were 150,000 people in Austin when I moved here.
Back when Austin was Austin.
When it was a different Austin.
Yeah.
You also had one Chinese restaurant, and that was the extent of
foreign
food, you know? That was going out to eat fancy if you went to the one Chinese restaurant in Austin.
Yep. I moved to Austin in 78, 79. I was in, they didn't call it middle school. I guess they did call
they
it.
They did, yeah.
I went to O. Henry.
Oh, my.
And on the weekends, we would just, actually after school, we would hop on our bikes and ride our bikes, down to the stadium at UT, just hang around campus, go up and down the drag, go play football on the stadium, in the stadium. Mm-hmm. And I am absolutely amazed now when I drive around that place that my mom was such a horrible parent that she would allow me to just ride my bike around that area. And I say that in jest because I'm talking about the way it is now.
Oh, absolutely.
There's no way she'd let me do it now, but it was such a different place.
Completely different.
Much smaller.
Completely different. Yeah, we moved here in the early 70s, and it was the same sort of thing.
Yeah.
You know, I look back at the things that I was able to do growing up in Austin, like at 16, riding my bike down to the Armadillo and hanging out until it closed down at 2 and then riding my bike back home.
Right.
And there was nothing wrong with that.
No,
it was not at all dangerous.
Place.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you went to ACC for EMT school, and then it sounds like you went to paramedic school.
I went to paramedic school there.
And what'd you do then? So this was, you graduated from paramedic school
in 92.
92.
Okay. And then 92, 93, I can't remember exactly when.
So right around the time I was coming back to Texas.
Absolutely. And I was working at Gold Cross while I was in paramedic school, which is the AMR precursor. Mm-hmm. And probably at that time, almost everybody that worked for Austin EMS had come through Gold Cross, you know, on the way up, and half the people that worked at Wilco.
Right.
Wilco was undergoing a change. John Sneed had just taken over as the director, and things mm-hmm. were really starting to move in a direction where good medicine was starting to really take off. I mean, it was primitive medicine back when we did this. I mean,
so I started here in 1988,
yeah.
And I think that you might be underselling how primitive it was.
I went and tried out in Austin, yeah. And I went and tried out at Wilco.
Yeah.
And Austin EMS hired me, but said you're going to need to be an EMT for a while.
Right, right.
It was back when Austin ran BLS trucks and ALS trucks, and Austin was the big time. They had 12 ambulances.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Absolutely. Wilco went, we want you now. We want you to be a paramedic.
Interestingly, I would suspect that Austin had an interview process and had testing, and the test, so George Stevenson hired me here, and my test was, can you figure out a way to get these keys into that ignition and drive?
Well, mine was a little bit more. They gave me scenario.
John had gotten involved.
They gave me a scenario, and I had a written exam.
There you go.
Now, my clearing process was John Sneed driving six of us around in a van, showing us where the station was, going, here's the keys, here's the drug box, don't kill anybody.
Yep. Yeah.
And then giving us to an experienced paramedic and saying, this is your partner, and it was their job to keep you from killing anybody until you got good at it.
John taking over the system is probably one of the best things that ever happened.
Absolutely.
He did amazing work. He and Dr. Benold really changed the system.
They did indeed. When I was doing my EMT write-outs, I had an opportunity to write at Wilco, and I didn't because I wasn't certain that I would learn the right things. Two years later, after John Sneed had taken over and I finished my paramedic, I thought this was a good place to work.
I agree with you. So you started here full-time when?
In June of 93.
So I'm an Aggie. I don't do math. So how long have you been here now?
I've been here 25 plus years.
25 years. So what is your secret to longevity?
Part of it is when I started. We had a different kind of medicine when I started. We didn't do 12 leads. We had a much smaller drug box.
Mm-hmm.
Or we had a bigger drug box full of very strange things. It was one or the other. And what happened when I got here was about 9 months into it, six of us got together and went, you know, there's so much stuff going on in EMS. There's so much research starting to happen. Let's go to Dr. Benold and ask him if we can show him all of this research. Can we maybe move from the cookbook that we're using to something like a scope of care? And he went, okay. And so we spent about 6 months and we broke it up in different pieces and we came up with all of the various cookbook standard procedures that we were supposed to be doing. And then we put it together and showed this is where the research is showing it needs to go. And then we went and did a huge pharmacopoeia of all of the indications, contraindications, the therapeutic indices and everything that had to do with the medications and put it all in there, handed him this giant book, put it on the table, and he went, well, my goodness. And he goes, give me some more about this and this and this. And so we went back and did more research, and he goes, well, this is very interesting. He was not aware at that point how much research was going on in EMS. And he was very interested in it. And he actually at that point started backing out of his private practice and proceeded to have his midlife crisis of becoming a paramedic. and he went with it. And I do remember sitting next to him at Eagles. And there was a somebody up there going, we're moving to something that we're calling a scope of care, and this is how it's going to work. And the people sitting behind us were from New Mexico, and somebody went to the microphone and said, we've been doing this for almost a year and a half. We would be glad to help you. And they went, oh, well, that would be great. And I turned to Dr. Benold, and I said, Dr. Benold, how long have we been using a scope of care? And he went, 14 years. So this was a place where not only did we have the opportunity to really improve the medicine, we had somebody who was going to help us drive it and let us be part of it. And I think that is part of what kept me here. I had an opportunity to help drive medicine in a way that kept me really challenged.
I mean, interesting.
I remember I had only been here about 6 months, and we had a patient in VTAC, and it was unstable VTAC. And at that point, we had to call for an order to cardiovert. And I called the hospital, and they said no. Mm-hmm. And so we did the oh-so-advanced procedure of precordial thump, which did not work. And so I had a firefighter drive us. We were in an apartment complex, and we told him, build up some speed and hit the speed bumps as hard as you possibly can. He took us 6 wheels off the ground. We came down. We broke some things on the shelf, but we cardioverted this patient with the speed bump. That was the kind of medicine that we were doing, and all of a sudden I was involved in the time of EMS medicine where that wasn't the way we were doing it. It was starting to pull research in and starting to pull in all the interesting things that we could do, adding more tools, adding 12 leads. So part of my longevity is I came along at a time when EMS was really starting to grow up and I got to be a part of it.
So Karen, for those of us who know you, I think most of us have detected some thespian tendencies. Where did that come from?
That came from being a thespian.
That would explain it.
It would, yeah. I went to UT. Yes, I did.
So just in case Dan Cohen is our audio engineer, and just in case his audio quality is breaking up here, I'm talking about thespians as in actors.
As in actors, as in the theater.
Correct.
The theater.
So where did that come from?
When I was in college, I went straight from high school to college, didn't take any time off. I was an academic nerd, and I found this small group theater that was doing a melodrama, which I had always enjoyed, and they were looking for actors, and so I auditioned.
I'm having a hard time seeing you in a melodrama.
Oh my goodness, Karen. I played a woman who was 6 years older than God and died of old age on scene. It was just a brilliant yeah. piece of thespian acting. And I did everything.
Thespianism?
Yeah, absolutely. I was, and I went, you know what? I'm a closet thespian. Mm. It's time to come out of the closet.
Well, you have certainly kicked that door down.
And I ended up dropping out of school and joining this repertory theater and making my living doing theater for a couple of years.
So I think most of our new hires will attest to this because they go through quite a bit of scenario testing. For those of you not at Williamson County EMS, we have quite a few scenarios, both in our academy and in our hiring process. And all of them, you play a starring role in all of those.
In most of those.
Batshit crazy patient.
Absolutely. I have been immortalized on many of our apparently slideshows and videos.
Yeah, I might have that in some of mine.
You do. And I believe that I acted in a couple of scenarios for you as well.
You may have, yeah.
Just a couple. No. So one of the things about EMS is I did a lot of things. I was a children's librarian. I taught second grade. I did theater professionally. I wrote legislation. And when I came to EMS, I found that I needed my theater. I needed my teaching. I needed my understanding of legality. I needed my ability to do research. I needed bits and pieces of all the things that I had done while having just a blast for the first 30-some mm-hmm. years of my life, and went, it's an element of EMS that I can respect because I'm having to use my brain and a limited toolbox to figure out what's going wrong. I don't have the need to do a lot of extraneous tests. I need to use my brain, and I need to use my tools, and I really, really like that. I like the fact that the consequences were if I messed up, somebody else got hurt. So I couldn't mess up. I had to really be on my game. I liked the self-challenge. And I liked the fact that everything that I had done up to then, I could channel it in there. I didn't feel like I had wasted my time doing all those things that gave me, you know, all the fun years that I had. And I'm still having fun, just in a different way, in a different focused way.
Having fun definitely will increase your longevity.
It does. And back in the bad old days, we had a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
We indeed, the tricks we pulled on each other are things we simply could not get away with now.
I remember my daughter was in the house and said, "Dad, I found this show on Netflix. It's about paramedics back in the 70s. It's Emergency. Why don't you watch this with me?" And I watched the first episode. And, you know, of course, like most paramedics of my generation, I remember watching Emergency Johnny and Roy as a kid. And I had not watched it in like 20 years.
Uh-huh.
And I remember thinking, what I remember and what the shows actually are many different things.
Many,
and
many different things.
I would have fired both of them.
Oh, absolutely.
For like five things in the first episode.
Absolutely. Yeah, well.
Leaning over and telling someone, she's just faking it. As I twitched my way through that.
Yeah. Oh, I totally agree with you. I completely agree with you. But I never even saw the show before I became a paramedic.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yeah. I grew up in the military, and we were overseas a lot. We didn't get access to things like that. So by the time I got back to the States, I was just entering high school.
Why didn't you just watch it on Netflix?
I don't even watch Netflix. I have a personal library of probably 20,000 to 30,000 volumes, and if I have downtime, I read. Don't watch.
Fair enough.
I don't watch.
Well, you said something that's very interesting that I think is important for all clinicians, and that is if you think that the things outside of medicine that you've learned make you a better clinician.
Absolutely.
I agree completely, regardless of what it is. When I see people who say they want to go to medical school, and they assume that they have to be a pre-med major, I'm like, oh, for the love of God, unless biology turns you on.
Do something
else. That's what wakes you up in the morning. Yeah. Do something else. Be a political science major. Be a psychology major. Be a history major. Be
Absolutely.
An art major. You got to learn the medicine no matter what. And it's the same way with paramedic school. Find something that really turns you on, that you really like doing, because it's not wasted. It will make you a better clinician.
It will make you a better human being.
I agree completely.
And one of the things we're seeing a lot of young people come into it because it's an exciting field, it's a growing field, it's a field where chances are you're going to be able to grow into it, and that's great. But then what happens when you have somebody who has practically no life experience, who comes across somebody who is being devastated?
Yeah.
It's not hard to have sympathy, it's not hard to have empathy, but it's really hard to have understanding.
Yeah.
You do the best you can. And you can come in and do this job as a 20-year-old, as a 21-year-old, straight from high school to paramedic school and come out and be an absolutely amazing medic and be an empathetic and wonderful person. But I bet 10 years after you've been here, you look back and you go, I can't believe I actually said that to a patient because I just didn't realize what they were going through, and now I do.
Well, you just described me. So I was a paramedic at 21. Actually, I think I graduated just before I turned 21 because I had to get my wife to buy me drinks. Well, my girlfriend at the time, Christy, before we got married. And absolutely, I like to think I was a great paramedic. I was certainly a lot more arrogant and cocksure than I am now. Turns out that life experience has a tendency to humble you.
It does.
But I definitely think I interact better with my patients now because I have some other life experiences to share.
Absolutely.
Well, Karen, so one of the points of the podcast is to talk to EMT and paramedic students, people just starting their careers out. And one of the questions I always like to close with is, what piece of advice would you tell them as they're contemplating a career? How can they turn what might be a brief career into a long and satisfying career?
Find a place that's growing. I became an SMO here, a senior medical officer here, in 2013. I never tried to promote any place else. I didn't want to be a supervisor. I was a supervisor at the Texas Legislative Council. I left an $80,000 a year job doing that because I could not continue to work in that environment, to take a $17,000 a year job being a paramedic. If I wanted to be a supervisor, I could have made a whole lot more money doing it. What I wanted to do was work with people. I waited until we actually instituted something that was a clinical path because I knew we were really starting to step up the rate at which we were changing. and I wanted to be a part of that. So be careful where you choose to work. Go absolutely any place that you can get your experience as long as you can learn. But keep your eyes out for a place that's going to continue to grow and change. Because doing the same thing over and over, 10 shifts a week, can get mind-numbing. It's not mind-numbing when there's always something else going on. When you can do some research and go to your medical director and say, are we thinking about this? And have the medical director go, actually we are, or go, no, but we should be. That you actually have a chance to grow your system and grow yourself. As long as there's change, this job stays vital. I understand that there are people who genuinely love working transport. I know people that have been doing it for 10 and 15 years, and they enjoy it because they can give a real service to some of these elderly patients who get completely ignored until they have somebody who actually cares about them. And they may be able to give them the best physical exam and the best consultation that person has had in months or maybe even years, and do real good. And that's what they want to do. And they've found their place. For others, I think you need to find a place where you're going to have a chance to continue to grow. Because as long as you keep growing, you're not ready to let it go. I'm not ready to leave Wilco yet. There's still too many things that are happening that I want to see the end of. At some point, I'm going to have to go, you know, that will continue to happen until I die. But at some point, you go, okay, it's time to move on to something else. But right now, we're still pretty vital, and we're still really moving, and we're growing, and I want to see what happens.
I think that's it. Yep, I like that. The things I enjoy most are learning. So when I'm on the steep end of the learning curve, that's where I'm happiest.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. When we're trying to figure it out, that's when it's exciting coming to work every day. Once you've got it done, it's like, okay, what are we going to do next?
What are we going to do next, indeed? I think that's a great way to wrap up. What are we going to do next? Always a great question. Karen, thank you so much for sitting down with us.
My pleasure.
Have a great day, y'all.